with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
At that very time, there were some present who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than all other Galileans? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did. Or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should we be wasting the soil?" He replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year, until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Is a very simple one. And I like to ask it to every parish where I serve. If it were to happen that this church were to close its doors, would it really matter to anyone apart from us who come within the doors Sunday by Sunday? A question we can never take too lightly. What difference do we make as a church community called to proclaim the good news to all God's people? What difference do we make in a world that has many questions, that has hope, that's dreaming for a better day? How can we who claim to bear the gospel of love help all to engage and to realize that dream and have their hopes fulfilled? And perhaps for us in this parish community, these past few weeks have been and can be instructive. For we have chosen to mount a series of discussions, conversations with our Muslim brothers and sisters. We've sought to open our doors to welcome everyone who has an interest in that conversation. For we hear day in and day out in the media, read and see it, one picture of the world through the eyes of the Western press. And many of us go ahead and go away with that impression as if it's the only world. We never seem to engage ourselves to discover for ourselves what are the real questions, what are the real issues, who are we dealing with as people, one to the other, one with the other. And we have been seeking to understand, to learn, to engage, to discover a little bit more about Islam. And what has blessed my heart in that exercise? We have been able to welcome into our pews in this church on Wednesday night for the past 2 weeks at least 10 persons, 12 persons, who are not members of our church, but who are curious to see and hear what we are talking about and how we as church are prepared to engage the world. And that for me, I think, is quite important. That hymn we just did for the gradual perhaps keeps that question in my mind. Hymn 572, let there be light. Open our lips. Open our minds to ponder. Open the door of concord, opening into grace. Perish the sword. Perish the angry judgment. Perish the bombs and hunger. Perish the fight for gain. That's the hymn we just sang. That's the hymn the church sings in our hymn book. How can we divorce that from the reality of engaging those whom we do not understand or whom we are led to believe are our enemies or are out to get us at all costs? With that in mind, therefore, let us think briefly on the gospel just read. It's a fiction, a parable Jesus told. Theologically, the fig tree was seen as Israel, a vine planted by God in the vineyard. Not a vine in itself, but a vine planted by God in a vineyard. Given a purpose and a role in that vineyard. It had a purpose to produce fruit for the planter. We know the story of that vineyard, of that vine. where it did not produce as God would have wanted time and time again. And God gave it a chance all the time to produce, to correct. God sent the Messiah to show that vineyard, that vine, how it can produce. Give it a chance to make a difference in the vineyard. The problem is that it did not produce as God would have expected. But God persisted and had patience. This time, you can still make a difference. But you've got to make a difference. Otherwise, I will find another vine. And isn't that what's happening in our world? When the church fails to meet the needs of people who come looking to it, for they know what it is about, and find that there's nothing there for it, what do? They find other vines. They find other opportunities. They find other places. They find other means by which they may come to a fuller understanding of what life is about and their place in God's world. So as we gather for our vestry this day, I invite us to ponder as we look at the past year. It was a good year. Reports suggest it was a good year. We had a wonderful anniversary celebration. Lots of things were happening, lots of food we ate, we heard many sermons, we saw many old friends, we did many things. It was a good year. I think the reports would also say we end the year without owing anybody anything. That's a good year. Thanks, the Lord is well did for the faithful stewardship. But we must look to the future. What does tomorrow mean for this church community? What would it look like in 4 years' time, 2020, for example? What would it look like? We have to make that possible. It's in our hands to make a difference. Let's not doubt our abilities to make a difference, my friends. Let's try new things. Let's be crazy for God. We cannot any longer be preparing the same things the same old way every time, do the same old things every time, and think it will be okay in the end. We will take the old with the new, find new ways, new possibilities, new dreams, new visions, do new things, do strange things. You wouldn't always succeed, but we tried. I pray God to lead us as we engage the future. Because as we heard in the beginning, God is faithful. We too must